Greetings, Zero and Repeater Books readers. For many of us on the left, the vibrant political tradition of Italian operaismo remains a source of great hope and interest, known for its hostility to any and all compromise with both capitalism and the state. This tradition largely came to the attention of English-speaking audiences through Steve Wright's book Storming Heaven, as well as Tony Negri and Michael Hart's Empire series. However, Gigi Ruggiero's upcoming book, Italian Operaismo, Genealogy, History, and Method, promises to overturn much of the received understanding of operaismo, especially through its living proponents such as Negri, Mario Tronti, and John Holloway. Accounts of operaismo have tended to focus on its two most famous figures, Tronti and Negri. However, Ruggiero's book focuses on a third figure who pioneered the militant strategy of co-research and has since been mistakenly overlooked, Romano Alquati. Joining us to discuss Gigi's upcoming book is also his translator, Clary Pope, to discuss her experiences translating Italian operaismo and her own encounters with Gigi's work. Thank you both very much for joining us today.
Thank you.
Thank you. Hi, everyone, and nice to be back.
I hope you don't mind, Gigi, if I begin by asking Clary a few questions about her translation before we get on to the book itself. What impresses me most about this translation is how well this poetical quality of Gigi's writing has been rendered in English. I don't often have the chance to say that a book I've read, as well as being really elucidatory, is genuinely a pleasure to read, but I feel confident in doing so here. What I'd like to know about are some of the challenges you faced while translating this book, and possibly also what your thoughts were on it, given your background with operaismo as well.
Yeah, thanks. Well, it's really nice to hear that you enjoyed reading it. And obviously that's large part thanks to Gigi, because obviously as a translator, it's much easier to translate something that's well written in the first place. And that's not always the case. Obviously also translating the book was helped a lot by the fact that I know Gigi, and so I'm like familiar with his style. I know the kind of intentions that are behind the book, and I also know his politics well, and so that helps me, because obviously when you're translating a book, you're not just translating words, you're translating ideas and arguments and intentions. So that the fact that I knew Gigi made that a lot easier. And then we also discussed where I had kind of doubts or questions about the translation I was able to discuss with him. So obviously it's hard to do that with writers who are dead. So I was kind of lucky in this case to have somebody who was, you know, who I could actually interact with. So that helps a lot. And I think for me, the fact that it being readable is really important, also because it's readable in the original. So a translation that isn't readable isn't a real translation. And I think too often I see translations of kind of Italian texts, or maybe in other languages as well, but I know the Italian text, when in the Italian it's maybe a very kind of clear and well-written and easily understandable text. And in the English, it becomes something that's unhelpfully complex and clumsy to read, and so it means it's more a distance from people, because people kind of see it as something that you can only access if you have a certain kind of like background or education. And I think this is maybe the problem in the book. Like, I've left some words in Italian, like formazione is a good example of this. And I think maybe we can talk about that word a little bit later with Gigi. But formazione is a concept that's widely understood in Italy, but there's not really an equivalent in English. And so it means something a bit more narrow than formation and something a bit wider than education. And so in the end, in conversation with Gigi, I decided to leave it in Italian. But, you know, I don't think we really had a choice with that. But at the same time, there's the risk that if you leave a word in the original language, it can be seen as kind of an academic concept or a difficult concept, when actually it's not supposed to be a difficult concept. It's supposed to be readable. And so I was worried about putting people off, and about these concepts kind of spinning off on their own away from the kind of context of the text, which, you know, is supposed to be, you know, readable. And also, you said, you know, poetic as well. And that's because of Gigi's writing's poetic. So, and that's also to do with preserving some of the foreignness of the original as well. And, you know, it's a real balancing act doing a translation. I think, you know, in some parts of the book I've managed, in other parts probably less so, but, you know, I'm really pleased that that you found it readable. Yeah.
I mean, I am a strong proponent, maybe for my sins, of leaving certain words untranslated. also for my sins, a lot of my research is on Gilles Deleuze. And there are a lot of words there are a lot of words in his work that there aren't really a good English equivalent for, a really good one being assemblage or agencement, which is not just a thing, it's the making of the assemblage and the decomposing of the assemblage. So it's always interesting how these words, although there's oftentimes a literal translation for them, the significance of the original word can't be conferred by its exact equivalent. So I guess with formazione, formation, you could talk about the formation of geological strata, which probably isn't exactly what Gigi is trying to get at here.
No, exactly. No. So, I mean, I think, yeah, as I said, I don't think we had really had a choice in that. But in the same time, I do think like a word like assemblage, I think the problem is that it gets used in academia, and so at a certain point, nobody really knows what it means anymore. Like when it's, I mean, maybe some people do, but it's a bit like the kind of emperor's new clothes. At one point, everybody's talking using these kind of words, and then someone says, so what does that actually mean? And it's actually very hard to, you know, because I do a lot of editing for academics as well, and, you know, I can see that there's this problem. So it's just about being aware that there's that risk. And that's why it's really important to have the footnote saying, okay, this is why we've decided to leave this word as it is, this is what it means, and so that people can always refer back to that.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you for that, Clary. As I said in my intro, most people who know about Operaismo know about it because of Negri and Tronti, or possibly even because of Agamben and Esposito. In fact, there is incredibly little in English on any of the other people who were involved with it, apart from maybe Bifo Berardi and Paolo Virno. This makes it all the more surprising that the person this book seems to most align itself with is Romano Alquati. So I'd like to ask Gigi, why has Alquati been overlooked so much? And could you possibly give us an overview of him and his life for those who haven't heard of him before?
First of all, thanks, Kenny, for this possibility of dialogue, and thanks, Clary, for what she said, and for her great work of translation, because I was to underline that this work of translation by Clary is not only a technical work, but it is first of all a political work. To answer your question, let me start saying that we need to be careful with the term operaismo, because this term seems to refer exclusively to the operai, that is to say the factory workers with blue collars and callous hands dirty with grease. In other words, the term operaismo seems one of the various Marxist current glorifying the workers as they are. They are heroic and universal efforts to save the humanity, glorifying the work. Nothing could be more wrong if one wants to understand what Italian political operaismo was in the 60s. In fact, it was an operaismo against work, and it was also an operaismo against Marxism. They called themselves Marxian and not Marxist. It was a radical rupture in the history of the Marxist tradition. And the operaismo was not, of course, against the operai, was not, of course, against the factory workers, but for sure was against their glorification. And, the operaisti bet on the workers who were going against themselves. That is to say, against their condition of oppression and their fate as victims. It was not on the side of the exploited, but was on the side of the exploited who fight against their condition of exploitation, not on the side of the victim, but was on the side of a political collective force. Let's say, let the poor, the victims, the weak people be taken care of by priests and the church. The operaismo as a movement of thought and as organizational praxis is grounded in the materiality of the class composition, in the practices of co-research within class composition. What I have said and these concepts in particular already make the importance of Romano Acquati, who was, let's say, the main protagonist of co-research practices and was, let's say, the first, I don't know if inventor, but I think ideator of the concept of class composition. Just a brief clarification for our audience. Class composition means the relationship between the capitalist articulation of the workforce and in its combination with the machines and the formation of the class as a collective subject. It is therefore the relationship between technical class composition and political class composition. Pay attention, it is not the reproposition of the Marxist relationship between class in itself and the class for itself, mediated by consciousness. Because consciousness, the concept of consciousness, is an idealistic a concept which belong to the tradition of a historicist and a universalist Marxism, the Marxist grounded on the Hegelian tradition, the Marxism that have a teleological idea of history, an history that proceeds through the stages of development. On the contrary, there is not necessity of the class struggle and communism. The operaismo is not a materialism of the necessity, but is a materialism of the possibility. The class struggle is not a necessity, the class struggle is a possibility. The operaismo is the rapture with universalism, the affirmation of an irreducible partisan point of view. There is no consciousness that drive the worker struggles, but to drive the work, the class struggle is the formation of a counter subjectivity. That is a subjectivity in a rupture with the way workers are formed. And co-research, what is co-research? Co-research is, first of all, a style of militancy. The co-research is a method of political action. It is a practice in which the production of knowledge is at the same time the production of subjectivity. It is at the same time the production of struggle. It is at the same time the production of organization. There is no more a separation between the production of knowledge and the production of organization. And this was the core research practices by Alquati and other comrades, starting from the end of the 50s and then during the 60s in the experiences of Quaderni Rossi and Classe Operaia. Alquati came from Cremona, that is a small city of Lombardia in the north in the north of Italy, and he went to Turin. Turin was in the 50s and in the 60s the principal, the main factory town in Italy. Was the corrispective of the Manchester of the 19th century in England, or the Detroit of the 20th century in US. And as I said, the concepts and the practices of class composition and co-research central to operaismo, you cannot understand the operaismo if you don't understand the class composition concept and the practice of co-research, and this concept and this practice are tied, first of all, to Romano Alquati. Alquati is known mainly for his practices of inquiry and co-research at Fiat in Turin, in Olivetti, near Turin, and in the factory town, and in this factory town. The articles of Quaderni Rossi, the Alquati's articles in Quaderni Rossi and Classe Operaia are collected in a book called Sulla Fiat e altri scritti, on Fiat and other essays, published in Italy in the middle of the 70s. I think some of these articles are available also in English. In this article and in this practice, because I repeat, the operaismo is not only a theory. First of all, the operaismo is a practice. Operaismo is a political praxis. In this Alquati's praxis, you can see the subjectivity of the central subject of this class composition. In the passage to the Tayloristic organization of the factory production. That is to say, the mass worker. You know, the mass worker is the worker of the assembly line. In Italy, was a worker for the main part that migrated from the south to the big factories of the north, particularly in Turin and in Milan. The mass worker is not only the subject of alienation and passivity, but he is first of all the subject of the autonomy with regard to the traditional organization of the labor movement and the subject of the refusal of work. When Alquati started the other comrades started these works of inquiry and co-research at the end of the 50s, the main idea was the defeat of the working class. The working class is definitely defeated. This was the idea of the labor movement. This was the idea of the Communist Party. We have to follow and to make an alliance with the middle class, because the factory workers are definitely defeated. And you can see these workers immigrated by the South. They are passive, they are extraneous, they are completely alienated. On the contrary, Alquati and the other operaisti saw in this mass worker not victims, but a potential force. And some years after this, there was their revolt in Piazza Statuto, and then there was the last great struggle of factory workers in Italy during the 60s, because the core research is a practice of anticipation of the possibility of the struggles. Is not the description of the struggles when they come out. Is a political bet of anticipation of this possibility. Then much less known is the subsequent path of Alquati. However, also the Alquati since the 70s is equally important. In the 70s, Alquati theorized the rise of the operaio sociale, that in English is social workers, but is one of the terms that with Clary we think that are quite ambiguous in the translation. So in the book you can find operaio sociale. Starting this analysis of operaio sociale, in Alquati started from the analysis of the university and the intellectual proletariat. And then in the 80s and in the 90s, are the period in which Alquati has elaborated he called the modellone, a big model, that is a proposal of the comprehensive reading of the functioning of contemporary capitalism and the hypothesis of a counterpart, that is a break and an exit from the capitalism itself. So we can put it in a very simplified way, referring back to the book for the discussion on this point. Let's say, if Mario Tronti is the great theorist of the political, and if De Negri, the other great figure of operaismo, for sure, to central figure of operaismo, as you said, Kenny, are quite known in the international level. So I said, if Tronti is the great theorist of political and Negri is the great theorist of the subject, of the revolutionary subject, we can say that Alquati tries to connect political and subject in the dynamic of the process and the possibility continuously to deviate, to overturn, and radically transform the process.
One of the things you mentioned there is this specifically defeatism of the left, especially in the context of the abandonment of the working class by the Communist Party of Italy, but we also see it at the same time by communist parties across the world. But at the end, in the interview, at the end of the book, you say operaismo is a thought of refusal and a thought of the negative as the foundation of communism. This kind of negative communism is making a comeback right now, I think, not only with the open Marxists, but also with the success of Marcello Tarì's There Is No Unhappy Revolution, the communism of destitution. I think this gets at what we Marxists have always been the best at, a ruthless critique of all that is. But there's this quote from the end of your book where you summarize your critique of what you call leftism that I'd like to read and ask you to explain further if you can. So what you write is, nothing is happening, the left repeats incessantly, while the radical left yells, let's resist, defend ourselves, and reproduce ourselves. getting carried away in the lexicon of rights and humanitarian reason, ranting with the contemptible sadness of senile wisdom or with the thinly disguised opportunism of individual fear. I'd like to hear more about who you mean by the left here, since you undoubtedly mean some group in society that's kind of opportunistic, possibly reformist, but ultimately defeatist, or that's involved in some kind of victimization, as you put it over the book.
Before to arrive to the matter of the left, that maybe is one of the scandalous matter of the book. I hope so. two quick clarification with regard to the first part of your question. The first one, the affirmation of the negative. Because during the 18s, the 80s and the 90s, in the era of counter-revolution and the postmodernist thought, on the wave also of French post-structuralism, I know that Kenny, you know very well. Maybe also on a sort of Deleuzean wave. But when we say Deleuzean wave, we are not necessarily referred to Deleuze, but from Deleuzean. No, you know that also Marx in the last years of his life said, je suis ne pas marxiste, I'm not a Marxist, I'm Karl Marx. The main parts of during this period, the main parts of critical theories argue the end of the negative. We have to be for, and we have no more to be against. On the contrary, the operaismo is a thought of conflict. Is a thought that pay attention of permanent conflict. The conflict is not only a stage of the revolutionary process, but is a permanent condition of the process of formation of the counter subjectivity. The conflict is the engine of the revolutionary process. Of course, conflict with the enemy, conflict with the capital, but at the same time, conflict within itself. Capital does not stand all in front of us. Capital is within us. We carry capital within us. It forms our subjectivity. Capital forms our ways of thinking, our ways of our behaviors, our desires, our needs. Revolutionary subjectivation is permanent conflicts against the enemy that we carry within us. Is a conflict also with us. Let's say is a sort of this thought of conflict by operaism is a sort of Marxian rereading of Nietzsche, and there's a sort of Nietzschean rereading of Marx. Consequently, the second clarification. I think that the dialectic between destituent power and constituent power is quite a false dialectic. Or rather, it is a dialectic within the process of revolution. The process of revolution is a process of destitution and the process of constitution. As the subjectivity, the formation of counter-subjectivity is a process of destitution of the capitalist subjectivity and the process of constitution of an autonomous subjectivity. In fact, the revolution as an exercise of power by a collective part is always a process of composition, combination, continuous composition of destitution and constitution. If we separate these two poles, if we risk on one end to exalt the ideology of the revolt, a fatuous fire that bursts out in few hours, or on the other way, we risk to make the apologia for institutional gradualism. That is an exercise of power without rupture. On one end, the exaltation of a rupture without perspective, and on the other side, the apologia of a power without rupture. So the institution and constitution are not alternative, is not an alternative, are not alternative poles, but are part of a process of a revolutionary process. The same thing can be said of the false alternative between spontaneity and organization. You know that spontaneity and organization is a traditional dialectic between the labor movement. But we can say there is no spontaneity without organization, and there is no organization without spontaneity. Romano Alquati, describing the wildcat strikes at the Fiat in the 60s, talked about organized spontaneity, this sort of oxymoron, but that describe this particular form of struggle and organization. And this combination, this composition of spontaneity and organization is also part of the particular rereading of Lenin by Operaismo against Lenin. Finally, the matter of the left. Operaismo is a radical rupture of the left. Even more, Operaismo has nothing to do with the tradition of the left. It's not the exit to the family of the left, to the leftist family, because Operaismo since the beginning has nothing to do with that family. It is not a new left, but is alien to the left. You can say we are operaisti, therefore we are not leftist. I would like to emphasize that I say this not because the left has become a certain way, but because left has always been that way. Since from its Enlightenment origins, the left has been progressist, innovationist. Left was, as you said, the thought of the defeat, the thought of the victim, of the victimhood, the thought of the impossibility of the autonomous struggle. The thought of the compatibility with the power of capital, the trust in history, and the hostility toward those who struggle against their own time. In the last years, we saw various political experiences that are called populist, You know, I think that the term populism is a very wrong term, because it's really a term that how do you say, is a sort of an insult to the very important tradition of the revolutionary populism in Russia at the end of the 19th century. Let's say we saw experiences demagogic, conservative from the north, from the League in Italy, to Bolsonaro, to Trump. I think are political experiences that born out of the dissolution of the dialectic between right and left. They born out in a very conservative or reactionary way. That born out not to fight to the with the system, but to conserve the system, to reproduce the system. But I think that we have to go beyond on the opposite way. So in the revolutionary way, we have to go beyond that exhausted dialectic between right and left. We can say that the contrary of the right is not left, but the contrary of right is revolution.
There are some more things there that I think would be interesting to pick up on, in particular in relation to how operaismo tends to be spoken of, especially among contemporary activists or militants. I must say, predominantly on the internet. whenever I see it as a fairly prominent phenomenon, that people will say, because of the critique of classical Marxism and of orthodox Marxism in operaismo, people will sometimes say that it's not Marxist, that it's not communist, but that it's actually a form of anarchism. And what you say about the relation to leftism, I think, is also possibly illustrative of this. There's a particular community of anarchists who share a lot of these worries and who articulate their worries in, I think, a comparable way. They call themselves post-left anarchists, and they tend to engage in these same critiques of leftism as a broad phenomenon, as being only concerned with the reproduction of, say, state power and the collective subjugation of individuals. So I'm wondering if you have any thoughts on the description of operaismo as anarchist rather than communist or Marxist, and whether you think in its relation to leftism, it can be described as post-left in the sense that anarchists use that term.
I think that your question is quite important, because I have the impression, but of course, you know this context better than me. I have the impression that in its international reception, the operaismo is often interpreted as a variant of anarchism and the libertarian thought. Or the reception is very similar to the so-called Marxist heresies, for example, Bordighism, particularly Bordighismo. I want to say that this is not the case at all, because I think the mistake, I think, was the is rooted in the idea of the autonomy. The autonomy the workers' autonomy, that is, of course, the one of the central hypotheses of operaismo, the autonomy of the class, is not at all entrusting of a spontaneous process. But it's always a process of organization within the class composition. There is no a refusal by operaismo of the organization and also of the matter of the party. And we have to say that operaismo and the problem of the party is, let's say, the black hole of the political experiences of operaismo. There is not at all a refusal. The research, the core research is first of all the core research of the new forms of organization within the class composition. But new forms of organization. When we talk about party, immediately we think to the institutional party. Of course, in the experiences of operaismo, there is the rupture with the Communist Party since the 60s, and there was also a rupture with the organization of the labor movement, so party and union. And then this rupture became during the 70s a frontal fight with the Communist Party. The Communist Party during the 70s was the state, the real state party against the autonomia operaia. When we talk of party, we are simply naming the problem of the forms of organization of the class. What is the overturning of the operaismo? That the forms of organization of the party are no more external to the class composition. The operaismo places the problem of the organization within the materiality of the class composition. And I think that in this way, this idea of the organization of the autonomia operaia is definitely the attempt to rethink the communism and also to reread Lenin beyond and also against the socialist tradition.
Well, you have brought up there the question of Marxist heresies, and I know we're getting slightly closer to the end of our interview, so I'd like to ask you one more question. And then hopefully we'll have time to ask Clary one more question. I'm really sorry to be directing all of my questions at Gigi. But as far as I can tell, this book is one of the first, if not the first, to explore the relationship between operaismo and Italian left communism, mostly through Amadeo Borga. But another important figure there is, of course, Onorato Daman. You mentioned Danilo Montaldi a few times, and he participated in Battaglia Comunista, a left communist group which was founded by Onorato Daman, and then later joined by Amadeo Bordiga, who then led a fraction, creating the ICP, or the International Communist Party. You criticize Bordiga and Bordigism quite a lot in this book, but I also think there are some interesting agreements between you and him. For instance, in the criticism of democracy, the criticism of council communism, and the criticism of anti-fascism, as Bordiga is sometimes thought to have said, the worst consequence of fascism was anti-fascism. could you talk more about the relation between operaismo and left communism or Bordigism, and maybe some of your agreements and disagreements here?
It's a very huge question. I mean, you are right. There are some direct connection, if we think to some figures, mainly Danilo Montaldi, who was not directly involved in the Operaista experiences. Was not in Quaderni Rossi or in Classe Operaia, but for sure was a very important source in the genealogy of Operaismo. Danilo Montaldi came from Cremona and was in direct relationship with Romano IV. Danilo Montaldi was a Bordighist, and it's quite curious that in the Bordighism there are various developments that are I say quite distant from the original source from the original Bordiga thought. For sure, Bordighism and Trotskyism are there are also some Trotskyist experiences that are quite interesting in the encounters with Operaismo. Let's think, for example, to the experience of Socialismo Barbari in France. But for sure, they are part of the Marxist heresies. The Marxist heresism, particularly Trotskyism and Bordighism, are very important, first of all, in the struggle against Stalinism, the various within and outside the Communist Party in the Western Europe. But these Marxist heresies are for sure part of the Marxist family. Paradoxically, Bordiga has often attacked Stalin as a sort of deviation from the line of historical development traced by Marx. Sometimes the Marxist heresies are an attempt to reaffirm a sort of Marxist orthodoxy against Stalin, who was a traitor of the Marxist orthodoxy. It was a fight within the real the real continuator of the Marxist orthodoxy. Operaismo was very distant on this point of view. Operaismo is I said before, a rupture of the idea of the historical development is a rupture with the idea of the teleological discourse of Marxism. In this way, there is also a particular rereading of Lenin. The Lenin interpreted by Marxist heresies was a very orthodox Marxist. On the contrary, the Lenin of the not all the Operaista were reread Lenin. We read Lenin, first of all, Tronti and Tony Negri, in part Alquati. But the main party of Lenin was the Lenin against the teleology. The Lenin who made the revolution where there was not the place and when there was not the time. the Lenin that imposed the revolution in an underdeveloped country as Russia. And so was a Lenin against the history with the capital H, the history of the teleological Hegelian Marxist discourse. In a very different way from the Marxist heresy, Operaismo is not at all a new church or a new orthodoxy or a school of thought or a dogma. I think that in the last 10-15 years, the attempt coming from the global university and mainly from the Anglo-Saxon academy to transform the Operaismo in the Italian theory is most anti-operaista can exist because Operaismo cannot be abstracted by the thinking and acting within the class composition. The Operaismo cannot be abstracting from the struggle and the organization of the struggles, cannot be transformed in a simple theory because it's first of all a revolutionary praxis. For Operaismo, Marx and Lenin were not sacred scriptures, were not Bibles to be restored, but powerful tools to be transformed and used. You know that Tronti said that we have to study what most hate. We study capital because we hate capital. And Tronti said that struggle that the knowledge is rooted in the hate. Is the Operaismo is always a thought of hate, hate against capital. And so the final question. Today, in a period, in a time in which that specific subject of Operaismo, that is the mass worker and that specific class composition, of course, are a remember of the 60s. Of course, the experiences, the political experiences of Operaismo ended in the 60s and then in different forms in the 70s. What remains of Operaismo? I think it doesn't remain, not at all, the Italian theory, but it remain the method, it remain the style. And this is a central matter. We have to return to the operaista style to go beyond the operaista experience. But we have not to come back, to return to the principles, to use the Machiavelli words, to restore the operaismo orthodoxy, but we have to return to the principle to overturn the press.
Well, again, I'm sure that there's a lot that I could ask you about there, and maybe we'll need to have you on another time.
I hope but, so.
Again, I think we are running out of time, and we do want to keep this relatively timely, because it's probably quite late for you both as well. So to close this conversation, I think it would be good if we could hear from Clary again. There are naturally some significant challenges when it comes to translating a book of political theory. Although, of course, Operaismo isn't just theory. and this exists not only as a problem across languages, although it is very much a problem with languages, but it can also exist as an issue of translation across cultures. So I was wondering if you had any thoughts on how this book is likely to be received by Anglophone audiences, given the very different historical constitution of class antagonism, not only in Britain, but across the Anglophone worlds.
Mm. Well, I think Gigi's already said kind of some of that in talking about the way that the operaismo has been absorbed in the kind of English speaking academia and being kind of like sapped of life or of its like conflictual nature. So I think that's the biggest danger. I think this book certainly could be read by a lot of people practically involved in struggle, and that will be, the book will be a failure if it's not, if it remains on university syllabuses. I think that's the issue. I mean, obviously across the English speaking world, there's a huge amount of struggle going on. It's just a question of whether the book reaches those people or not. I think, you know, Gigi says in the preface to the book that it needs to be used as a tool, it needs to be kept alive. And that really does mean engaging with it critically as well. And I think, you know, he's already just said about, you know, how we should relate to operaismo. It's not a church. It's, you know, we need to be, continue to be the dog in the church, which is how Guido Borio describes Alquati in the book. And again, Alquati is another figure, which I think it's really important that, you know, it's obvious, particularly in the kind of like, in the United States and the UK, for instance, maybe there's just this sort of real, and within, you know, English speaking academia in those countries, there's this real kind of desperate need for like a new theory or a new thinker or just some answer to the problems, you know? And obviously Alquati is not a new thinker, but he's maybe being newly sort of arrived in the UK and in the US. And I think we've got to be careful not, as I said, to create this kind of new church. Because what's interesting about Alquati and why the reason why he was able to create these kind of, or, you know, be part of the creation of these concepts of like, and practices, more importantly, of class composition and co-research, was that he engaged critically with texts that and movements that came before him and that were contemporary with him. And if we stop doing that and think we can just find the kind of the answers, and then that's when it becomes a problem. And I think that's the same, you know, in relation to Gigi's book as well. We should engage with it as we should engage with all political texts and maybe even all texts in this way, in this kind of critical, practical way. I think one of the interesting things about Gigi's book is that it kind of presents itself as an introduction, and it is also an introduction, and it can definitely be used as an introduction, but it also has a very strong point of view. And I think that that's refreshing, because often introductions, they always have a point of view, obviously, but usually that's kind of hidden. This one definitely is not hidden. And so it's a challenge. It's presenting a challenge. It's not claiming to have the final word on operaismo and all that period in history. And to keep it alive, we need to also challenge that challenge, you know? We need to create our own challenges, our own capacity for anticipation, organization, struggle, and so on, using what we can of it and using what's useful to us. I think that's the most important thing, that the book's kept alive, and that's to do with how it's, yeah, that's all to do with how it's received at the other end and how people read it and how people use it.
Well, again, thank you both so much for coming onto the show.
Thank you, Daniel. Thank you, Terry.
Maybe like just before we end, I was wondering if you two have anything that you would like to plug for our readers. Obviously, there's this book that's coming out at the end of this month. But if there's anything else going on in your lives that you'd like to share with our listeners, please go ahead.
Habitually, I talk a lot, so I think that it's better to stop to stop here, because your questions were very good. It's okay. It's okay. And I think it was really a very good dialogue. And I want, in a very not formal way, to thank you, Kenny, and to say thank you again to Clary, because Clary talked about challenge, and I think the best way to approach this book and these topics, more than these books, is the challenge, because you have not to read this book to simply understand what operaismo was, but in which way the operaismo is able to challenge what we are doing and what we think. I think this is the best way in which we can approach this book and possibly also to criticize, because we say that the operaismo is a thought of conflict, and so I think a peaceful reading of this book is the worst way to read this book. I hope in a conflictual reading of this book.
Clary, is there anything that you wanted to add? I know that you do a lot of translation work on the side. Are there any other projects that you have coming up?
Nothing that I can talk about. I did publish a comic, but last year. But that's also political. But it's nothing to do with this project. So I think it would be inappropriate to put in this thing. But I've written a so-called graphic novel called Welcome Home, which was published last year. But you should get hold of it. But maybe this.
All right, here, folks.
That's my other personality. That's where I'm. Instead of Clara.
No, thank you for bringing that up. That sounds excellent. If anyone sees a copy of it at their local bookstore, I'm sure they'll be eager to pick up a copy of it. And when this comes out, Italian Operaismo, Genealogy, History, and Method. Thank you both so much. And
Jenny, I can also add that just in this month, it was out in Italy a book that I wrote, a sort of pamphlet called in Italian Per la critica della libertà, that is something to criticize the freedom. So I think it's quite connected to a lot of things that we discussed. And if someone is not enough scandalized by this book, they can read this other book.
Excellent. Thank you for bringing that up. I'll try to find a link to it and put that in the show notes below. But again, yes. Thank you both very much. And vogliamo tutto, as they say.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Kenny.
We appreciate your support of the imprint and the channel. Subscribe to Zero Books Today on Patreon. Your material support helps us to promote a variety of perspectives on the left. Also, discover the many titles, new and old, that Zero has curated. Navigate to any of the links in the show notes to extend your support.